Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this lecture in the series of Al-Furqan lectures on Islamic written heritage, organized by the Center for the Study of Islamic Manuscripts at Al-Furqan. Thank you for honoring us with your presence. Tonight's lecture is entitled Vestiges of Dissolved Libraries, Tracing Damascene Manuscripts. Before I introduce our keynote speaker, I'm delighted to invite Mr. Sharaf Yamani, member of Al-Furqan's Board of Directors, to welcome you on behalf of the board and its chairman, Sheikh Ahmed Zaki Yamani.
Thank you, Celeste, and good afternoon, everyone. And I welcome you to this public lecture on behalf of the Yamani Cultural and Charitable Trust and on behalf of the Board of Directors of the Al-Furqan Islamic Heritage Foundation and its chairman, Sheikh Ahmed Zaki Yamani. Today's lecture, given to us by Professor Konrad Hirchler, falls within the frame of Al-Furqan's public lectures, which aims to strengthen the links with those who are interested in the Islamic heritage and culture. As you might know, the Al-Furqan Foundation has organized more than 60 lectures so far on different aspects of the Islamic heritage, and we are proudly continuing this tradition tonight. The foundation has also a long tradition in identifying and preserving any endangered heritage around the globe. For example, the foundation played a significant role in cataloging and restoring the Bosnia manuscripts during the Bosnia War. Also, we were among the pioneers in identifying manuscripts in Timbuktu, Mali, by cataloging a big part of the manuscript collection in the mid-90s of last century. And this year, in the backdrop of the human catastrophe occurring in the Middle East, the Al-Furqan Foundation will devote a few activities to shed light on the fate of the historical cultural heritage in Syria, which as a result of the ongoing war, part of this heritage has been destroyed, and unfortunately the remaining part is endangered. Like tonight's lecture, there will be other activities during which we will commemorate and promote the different aspects of this heritage in Syria. Among such activities will be the launch of the book Bughyat al-Talab fi Tarikhi Halab, The History of Aleppo, written more than 800 years ago by Kamaluddin ibn al-Azm, ibn al-Azim, Azim, Biddal, Azim, an editing project that was supported and sponsored by Al-Furqan and published recently. The event will take place on the 4th of October, and I do hope everyone here has the chance of attending. Now, this book is quite distinguished in that it draws together a variety of disciplines in different fields of knowledge. Its main topics are the biographies of eminent personalities and intellectuals of various scientific and humanistic fields, as well as political figures and men of power with connection to the region of Aleppo. It features descriptions of towns and countrysides, especially in the area, the north of the Levant, and it documents a long period of Islamic history. The author of this book, Kamaluddin ibn al-Adim, was amongst the most eminent historians of his time. He is also one of three aides, interestingly, who participated in the smuggling and protection of manuscripts during the Mongol invasion in the mid-13th century. Now, unfortunately, in this case, history does repeat itself. Syria and the region surrounding it is boiling. The future is under threat. And you see it through the eyes of the victims of this human failure, men, women, and children, whom are deprived of their basic human needs of food, shelter, medicine, and I would add to that education. History and culture is under threat as they are part of our psychology and DNA, and trying to alter or destroy it in any way suppresses and unbalances us and our identity and who we are and who we might become. And therefore I say, as well as the future, the past is under threat through the destruction of the historical cultural capital preserved in the country's walls, artifacts, and manuscripts. Great efforts will have to be undertaken, emulating the spirit of individuals like Kamaluddin ibn al-Adim more than 800 years ago, Ibn Nadim more than 1,000 years ago, and less known individuals more recently like Dr. Abdul Qadir Haydara, whom masterminded the smuggling of the manuscripts in Timbuktu, Mali in 2013, or Dr. Mustafa Jahik, who played a significant role in preserving the manuscript of the Ghazi Khusrov Bey Library in Sarajevo during the Bosnia War in the mid-90s. To reverse this constant annihilation of those human treasures, a lot will have to be done. We play a small role in this by providing a platform and several means of support for the real champions of this struggle. They are our educators, our historians, our researchers, our librarians, our museum directors, and so forth. And one of them is here with us tonight. We are grateful for Professor Hirchler to take the time away from his busy schedule to come and speak to us tonight. And again, I welcome you all, knowing that you will be enjoying an excellent lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sharaf, for being with us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight's lecture discusses the rich manuscripts and library culture of Damascus up to the 20th century. Because of the current war in Syria, cultural artifacts, including manuscripts, have been damaged or displaced. This lecture provides possible approaches for future research on the provenance of manuscripts. Professor Hirchler will teach us how to follow the trails of manuscripts by discussing, as an example, the movement of the manuscripts held at the Omariya Madrasa Library in Damascus. I would like to provide you with some background information on Professor Konrad Hirchler. He has been Professor of Islamic Studies at the Freie Universität Berlin since 2016, and was previously Professor of Middle Eastern History at SOAS, University of London. Over the last few years, he has primarily worked on the history of reading, history of the book, and history of libraries in the Syrian lands. Currently, his main project is concerned with the materiality of Arabic manuscript cultures. This includes the digital reconstructions of Damascene legal documents during the Mamluk period. Konrad Hirchler is the author of Medieval Damascus, Plurality and Diversity in an Arabic Library, 2016, The Written Word in the Medieval Arabic Lands, A Social and Cultural History of Reading Practices, 2012, and Medieval Arabic Historiography, Authors as Actors, 2006. We are honored to have Professor Hirchler with us tonight, and I'm delighted to invite him onto the stage.
Yeah, thank you very much for this introduction. Thank you very much for the welcome. It's a particular pleasure and honor to speak here tonight at Al-Furqan as an organization which has contributed greatly to the support of research and preservation of manuscripts, and from which I also have benefited greatly over the last years. The project or the material I will be speaking about tonight would not have been possible without the support by Al-Furqan. So it's a very, very adequate forum for me tonight to speak here. Okay, talking about dissolved libraries in the Middle East, and in particular Syria, has obviously a great resonance on account of the armed conflict in the region over the past years. In the framework of these conflicts, cultural heritage has been damaged beyond question, but more often cultural heritage has been specifically targeted either for ideological reason or with the aim to plunder valuable artifacts to resale them on the international markets. And that's certainly the much larger challenge which we face over the next years, rather than destructions. Manuscripts collections have been one of the targets of cultural heritage, and the current fate and state of the collections of Mosul, and to some extent also Aleppo, for instance, is entirely unclear. Whatever happened, it is beyond doubt that manuscripts have been destroyed in Mosul. The Waqf Library in Aleppo was, for example, situated in proximity to the Grand Mosque, which was severely damaged. The manuscripts had been partly evacuated before the attack, but it's not entirely clear whether they had been fully evacuated. But as I said, apart from this destruction, the main challenge is really that to a much larger degree, many manuscripts have been plundered and sold to buyers worldwide over the past years and will reappear in an entirely new context in the course of the next years. These manuscripts have thus been taken out of their institutional context, and it will be a major task to recontextualize these manuscripts in the years to come in order to understand their historical trajectory. This task is obviously not too different from what colleagues working on other material artifacts face, where clay tablets, vases, mosque lamps, etc., have been taken out of their museum context and are in dire need to be re-identified to regain their historicity, so to say. The disappearance of libraries and the decontextualization of manuscripts is certainly not a new phenomenon in history. And what I want to do today is to talk about my work on the history of libraries in medieval Syria, or rather former libraries, with the manuscripts now being dispersed all over the world. And I hope that the methodology used in the framework of my research on vanished medieval libraries might be of some interest when the moment will come, hopefully, to trace the fate of libraries and individual manuscripts which have been moved over the last years in the course of the armed conflicts. Okay, so the lecture will take us to Damascus in the 13th century, a period when many cities in the Middle East witnessed a rapid increase and expansion in the number of libraries. And if we look back at the history of libraries in the Middle East over the last centuries and millennia, it is fair to say that this period, the late 12th, 13th, early 14th century, was a turning point, where the library became part and parcel of the urban infrastructure. On this map, you see the main educational institution founded in late 12th and 13th century Damascus. Virtually all of them, i.e. that are these numbers, virtually all of them had book collections. And these are obviously only the institution within the city walls, and there were many more institutions around the city in adjacent quarters. It is important to underline that at this point, we still don't have standalone libraries, independent libraries. That doesn't exist. That's only a phenomenon which appears in the Middle East in the 17th century, starting in Istanbul. And during this period, a library is always attached to a mother institution. We know relatively little about the exact profile and size of the individual libraries, as research on medieval libraries has only been gaining traction over the last years, and the field of medieval library history is in many ways still a terra incognita. However, there's one case which is well documented by now, and that is the Ashrafiya Library, which is the small number 187 here on the map. The Ashrafiya was a minor institution within the scholarly landscape of the city. It was not one of the heavyweights like the Dar al-Hadith, al-Nuriya, or other institution. And we only know of its library because it's one of the few examples, one of the rare cases, where a medieval library catalog has been identified. I don't say one of the rare cases where a library catalog has survived. I believe many more catalogs have survived, but we have not identified them yet. But that's a library catalog which has been identified. As you can see, it's today held in Istanbul in the Süleymaniye Library, a point to which I will return later on. In my recent book on this very library, I showed that this institution, even though it was a minor player within the Damascene scholarly landscape, housed a library with some 2,000 books. And this is a considerable number, taking into account that, for example, in medieval Britain, even the largest libraries did not hold a larger collection. For example, if you look at Norwich Cathedral Priory, at Christ Church Cathedral in Canterbury, Bury St. Edmunds, and they all had collections which were smaller than this small library in Damascus. And as late as the 15th century, all of the libraries of Cambridge University, taken together, possessed less books than the Ashrafiyya Turba. So the fact that such a small institution contained such a massive library speaks to the fact that we are talking about a very bookish society, about societies where, at least from the 13th century onwards, the library had become deeply ingrained in the urban landscape, offering a wide array of books to different reading audiences. However, there's one slight problem when talking about medieval libraries in Damascus, and the same goes to a large extent for other cities in the Middle East, namely the problem that none of these institutions has survived until today. There's not a single Damascene library which is still in situ, which is still in the place where it used to be in the medieval period, which is obviously slightly different from the situation in Europe, for example, where we still have quite a number of monastery libraries, for example, which are still in situ. Many of the buildings have disappeared, so all that is left of what used to be the Ashrafiyya institution is this rather unremarkable tombstone on the side of a road in Damascus, which is still there. So the photo is from 1995, but the tombstone is still undamaged in Damascus. And this is obviously a very crucial problem in writing the history of medieval Middle Eastern libraries, that so many of them have disappeared. And even if the building of the mother institution still exists, we generally do not know where the library was placed. Very few of them left easily identifiable materials, such as library catalogs, or at least we have not identified them. And the deeds of endowments of the foundations, which are obviously of crucial importance in order to understand these libraries, have not come down to us in the case of Syria. For Egypt, obviously, it's a very different story. But for pre-Ottoman Syria, we don't have a considerable corpus of endowment deeds, which could even be vaguely compared to what we have on Egypt. Our limited knowledge of medieval Middle Eastern library is not just antiquarian problem, but has led to some rather unfortunate assumption on what these libraries contained. Many of these libraries were attached to madrasas or other institution of education, and it was assumed that most of these libraries contained first and foremost books from the field of religious knowledge, such as tafsir, hadith, and especially fiqh. This assumption seems logical, but the Ashrafiyya, basically the first documented medieval library, tells a very different story. Namely, the majority of the works on its shelves did not belong to these fields of knowledge, but we find a very broad thematic profile where works from the field of adab and poetry, from mathematics, from medicine, constituted the vast majority of works. And tafsir, hadith, fiqh was a minority. So this reflects a rather broad intellectual world which does not agree with outdated assumption of the role of madrasas and the intellectual world of those who endowed and used their libraries. So the basic challenge which we face is to find ways of how to write the history of medieval Middle Eastern libraries when much of its materiality has disappeared and often nothing more than vestiges remain. However, while the buildings have disappeared, while few catalogs have been identified, while the endowment deeds are not extant, one element of libraries has survived in large number, and that's the books, the manuscripts themselves. And the beauty of these manuscripts is that users tended to leave their marks on them, especially when it comes to ownership. Here, just one random example of a manuscript which was written during the Zangid period in Damascus and which is today still held in Damascus in the National Library. It's a handbook of Hanbali law, As you can see, it's not a particularly splendid manuscript when it comes to decoration or mise en page, but this is obviously the way most manuscripts looked, which were used, and these splendid manuscripts, which one sees in exhibitions, etc., are obviously the small minority of the day-to-day life of books. On this title page, we see four different ownership statements underlined in yellow, where different owners over a long period claim the authorship. And we also have an endowment notice, which is really rare. We normally don't have endowment notices on medieval manuscripts, where a certain Ahmed ibn Yahya al-Najdi endows a manuscript. In addition, we often find notes on individual readers and for public reading sessions, sam'at, which both again yield a wealth of data on the trajectory of a manuscript. We are only in the very early stages of bringing this material, i.e. the ownership statements, the sam'at, and all the other usage traces on manuscripts into a way that we can actually work with it. We don't have anything even close to a large-scale database which would bring this data from the manuscripts dispersed over the world together. And this is a major problem, or a major lacuna in our field, because I believe that this is one of those source genres which can contribute greatly to a much richer history of Syria, but also obviously to the other Arabic Islamic lands. There are some attempts to start these databases, but we are really in the very early beginning to use the incredible data which we have here. In the case of the Ashrafiya Library, such notes have allowed me to reconstitute parts of its holdings. That was basically the challenge for me. There's a library catalog from 13th century Damascus. I have identified the titles, but where are the manuscripts today? The manuscripts hardly ever carry a note which says Khizanat al-Malik al-Ashraf or Waqf al-Ashrafiya or anything like that. So this is one of the rare cases where we have an explicit statement of a manuscript where it said that it is for the Khizanat Maulana al-Sultan al-Malik al-Ashraf. But that's obviously really the exception of manuscripts when it comes to medieval manuscripts culture. As you can see, this manuscript is again in Istanbul, again in the Süleymaniye Library, and the Ashrafiya Library was most likely taken to Istanbul after the Ottoman conquest in the early 16th century, where we find most of the manuscripts today. What I want to do in the following is to discuss the case of this library, another medieval library, which is the Amariya Madrasa outside of Damascus. At least parts of its building have survived. They have been heavily restored in the 1990s. They've been restored beyond recognition, one might say. It looks quite fanciful, but it's very difficult now to still get a feeling for the historicity of these buildings. The institution takes us outside the city walls, so that was the map which we saw before with all these numbers, and now we are moving to the west of the city, up the Mount Kasyun, to the Salahiyya Quarter, which was obviously the hotbed of Damascene Hanbalism. Where we have the main institution of Hanbali scholarship in Damascus. The Amariya Madrasa was quite a substantial foundation. It was arguably the most important Hanbali Madrasa in Damascus during the medieval period. We don't know exactly where the library was, but most likely it was here in the mosque room with shelves on the walls, but that's really nothing more than a moderately informed guess. None of the manuscripts which once belonged to this library are still in situ, as the madrasa had become dysfunctional by the 19th century and its books were moved to a new location, which we will see later on. The Umariya is special because it has left another Fihrist. This is another one of the rare example of a medieval library catalog which has survived. Sadly, it's not a catalog of the entire library, in contrast to the Ashrafiyya, which we saw before. The Ashrafiyya was for the entire library. This is basically by the scholar Ibn Abdel Hadi, who makes a supplementary endowment to an existing library. So he endows an additional collections to this library for the benefit of his family and himself. So this is Fihrist al-Kutub, waqf katibihi ala nafsihi, wa ala awladihi, thumma awladihim, and so on, basically for his offspring. Ibn Abdul Hadi was a very prolific scholar of late Mamluk Damascus. He authored around 500 books, and he was also a spectacularly unsuccessful scholar. Almost all of his books have survived in autographs, i.e. they were not copied by anybody. It's one of the, normally we want autographs. In the case of Ibn Abdul Hadi, we want non-autographs. We want something else, but they don't. I've so far found with 500 books, there are 2 books which have been copied. And 498 seemingly were never copied. But at least Ibn Abdul Hadi was quite successful in setting himself a lasting monument in the form of this Fihrist. His collection contains some 600 books, or let's say codicological units, with roughly 2,000 titles. Because many of these manuscripts were multiple text manuscripts, i.e. one manuscript contains up to 18, 20 titles. So we have many more titles than actual physical books. The book collection of Ibn Abdul Hadi has not survived as one corpus until today, but has been widely dispersed. So the task is to reconstitute this library to identify them in modern day collections. So that's basically what I want to show you today, how to do this. We have this medieval library catalog. We know all these books were in the 15th century in the Umariya. We know they're not there anymore. So where are they? How can, are we able to reconstitute the corpus of manuscripts which we have? First of all, it has to be said that an endowment was meant for eternity in theory only. This is true in the past, this is true today. This is obviously expressed in the Arabic term waqf mawquf, i.e. that it should be for eternity, which literally means something is immobilized, it's withdrawn from the normal circulation of goods. However, endowed manuscripts did very often only remain immobile for some years, perhaps decades, if the founder was really blessed even more than one century. But a waqf library that survived over several centuries is a rare, rare exception. This hardly ever happened. And this has not so much to do with theft or plunder, but much more with the fact that the mother institution had become dysfunctional and the library thus orphaned. The Ashrafiyya library, which I mentioned in the beginning, which was taken to Istanbul, was not so much taken to Istanbul as booty and as plunder, but rather because the Ashrafiyya Madrasa, the mother institution, had ceased to function as an educational institution, and so its library was easily moved to a new destination. In the case of Ibn Abdul Hadi's endowment, we see that some manuscripts were remobilized, so to say, very quickly after his death, which is evident from notes on manuscripts. So this is a typical Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscript. Take notice of his handwriting. He has a very distinctive handwriting, which you will see again and again tonight, because it's autographs which have survived. It's a work on Sufism, and again, very typically, sadly, this stamp by the post-independence librarians has made part of the note hardly legible, but it's an ijaza, a permission to transmit to his children, Auladi, that they have the permission to transmit this work on Sufism, which we will again see again and again. What is interesting here is this note on the bottom of the manuscript, where a new owner says, this is actually my manuscript. And this owner This note must have been written on this manuscript after the endowment for Ibn Abdul Hadi, and only a maximum of 30 years after the endowment. So within 30 years, this manuscript had already left the endowment and was on sale in Damascus. Interestingly so, the new owner is Muhammad ibn Tulun, who's a very well-known scholar of Damascus and a pupil of Ibn Abdul Hadi. And more interestingly so, the seller of this manuscript is Abdul Hadi, to make things confusing, Abdul Hadi, who is the son of Ibn Abdul Hadi. So basically, the one to whom benefit this manuscript was endowed resold it after the death of his father in Damascus. And we find quite a considerable number of manuscripts with Ibn Tulun, Abdul Hadi sale notes on the manuscript. This is not the place to discuss the legal implications of what is going on here. Suffice is to note that manuscripts remained highly mobile even if they had been endowed, and this was not the exception, but rather the rule. The mobility of endowed manuscripts is not only evident in the fate of Ibn Abdul Hadi's manuscripts after he had endowed them, but also if we look at the trajectory of the manuscripts by other authors which had come into his possession and which he then endowed. So this is not an autograph. This was owned by Ibn Abdul Hadi, but he bought it on the book market. And the circle here shows this is a waqf mu'abad, maqarahu bi dhiya'iyya. The dhiya'iyya is a dar al-hadith of the dhiya'iyya in Damascus, which was founded 200 years prior to Ibn Abdul Hadi's life. So this manuscript had been endowed in the dhiya'iyya, and then somehow it had come onto the market and into Ibn Abdul Hadi's hand, private ownership, and then he had re-endowed it into the Umariyya, after which it was resold on the Damascene book market, came into private ownership, was again endowed in an institution. So, and that's a typical back and forth of manuscripts which we find over and over again. So if somebody buys a manuscript which had previously been in an endowment, it's not necessarily something illegitimate, because very often these guys themselves endow them afterwards. So it's very much a case of circulating manuscripts within a city or within a wider region. So let us have a look at the trajectory of the manuscripts after Ibn Abdul Hadi's endowment, i.e. let us try to reconstitute its late medieval shape by tracking down manuscripts that had once sat on its shelves. The first journey takes us to modern-day Morocco, where in the early 17th century, the Sayyid ruler Maulay Zaidan owned a splendid palace library inherited from his father, and which he wanted to transfer in a moment of military conflict by ship to Agadir. He brought in a French ship with a rather dodgy captain. It's not entirely clear what happened, but in the end, the French captain sailed off with all of Maulay Zaidan's household goods, including his library. So the library was lost. The French captain only made it to Gibraltar when the Spanish imprisoned him for pirateering and took the library. And the library made its way to the royal palace and monastery close to Madrid Escorial, where Al-Furqan Foundation has been running training courses quite for a number of years. The Escorial collection is currently subject to a European Research Council's project run by Nuria Martinel de Castilla and François de Roche. And it's particularly fascinating because it's, so to say, an early modern library in a time capsule. We don't know exactly how many libraries went out, how many libraries came in after 1612, but they are few. And we have hardly any early modern royal libraries in a time capsule. So if we find a manuscript at Escorial, the beauty is that we can attach a date to it, i.e. this library must have come to Morocco before 1612, and then subsequently made its way to modern-day Spain. For most other manuscripts which have made their way to new shores, we are in a much less fortunate position to know when they left Ibn Abdul Hadi's endowment at the latest. as the current repositories are not time capsule of earlier clearly defined collections, but were constituted from a multitude of small-scale purchases from much less clearly identifiable sources. A crucial period when Middle Eastern manuscripts started to move on a large scale, and thus also Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, was obviously the second half of the 19th century, when European buyers started to play a major role in purchasing manuscripts in Middle Eastern cities and transporting them to European libraries. And one of them was the French diplomat and Orientalist Charles Schaeffer, who built up a considerable private library, which in the 1890s made its way to the Bibliothèque Nationale de France. He himself most likely was buying manuscripts in Damascus in the 1870s. This is one of these books, Al-Fawa'id, so a book of hadith by Diya ad-Din al-Maqdisi. This is the guy who had founded the Dar al-Hadith of the Yahya, which I had mentioned earlier, where the other manuscript came from. And where we see, again, a note by Ibn Abdul Hadi. This case, he himself claims basically an ijaza for this work, i.e. that he has the permission to transmit it. Sadly, these, and on the following page, that's the same manuscript. On the following folio, we see again Waqf al-Hafidh Diya ad-Din in his Dar al-Hadith of the Ya'iyah. So a typical feature again. This had been an endowment. Ibn Abdul Hadi bought it and re-endowed it. These Schaeffer Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, which are in Paris, had been lost from view for quite a while because, sadly, for some weird reason, they were identified among the Supplement Turc collection. Obviously, there's nothing Turkish about them whatsoever, but they should have been Arab collection. They are still misclassified, and thus they had not really come to the attention of scholarship for quite a while. Some two decades earlier than Charles Schaeffer, Johann Gottfried Wettstein was in Damascus and bought thousands of manuscripts in the city, which he later sold to several libraries in Europe. Most of them he sold to the, at that point, Prussian library in Berlin. And here again, we see an example, which is today held in the Berlin Staatsbibliothek. Again, you can see this is an autograph by Ibn Abdul Hadi with his distinctive handwriting. Again, we see the ijaza for his children, Auladi. Aulad here does not mean sons, it means children, including his daughters. And he identifies himself, Jama Ka Tibuhu Yusuf Ibn Hassan Ibn Ahmed Ibn Abdul Hadi. What is interesting here is that we also see an ownership notice by a certain Saleh Ibrahim Ibn al-Munayyar, dated to 1804 or 1218 Hijri. And this Ibn al-Munayyar repeatedly appears on Damascene manuscripts which made their way to Berlin. So either al-Munayyar himself, but probably he was too old, one of his descendants or somebody who bought his connection must have been one of these middlemen, of these traders of manuscripts on which the European buyers relied. We do not know yet at all how this market actually worked in the late 19th century, but this will certainly be a promising entry point to understand who the sellers were. What can be said, however, is that this manuscript had left Ibn Abdul Hadi's endowment long before the European buyers appeared on the market. So it's not the case, basically, that with the European buyers, books were taken necessarily out of endowments, but this is another case of a manuscript which had already been circulating on the Damascene book market for quite a while. In the case of 19th century trajectories of manuscripts, the two I've presented, Schaeffer, Paris, Wettstein, Berlin, it is in most cases clear from where these buyers sourced their material, i.e. that they went from Damascus to Paris, from Damascus to Berlin, and not from another Middle Eastern city. When we come to 20th century movement, it becomes much more complicated to ascertain whether manuscripts really moved from Damascus or from other cities to the new depositories. And a prime example for this is the Chester Beatty Library in Dublin, set up by the American businessman Alfred Chester Beatty and granted probate in 1969. This library reflects a private collection built up over a very extended period. It also includes, once again, Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, again, an autograph by him. Again, you see the ijaza for his children, which he wrote on this manuscripts. But to track down how this manuscript came into the possession of Chester Beatty is much trickier to research. As Chester Beatty built up his collection over his lifetime and purchased his material from a wide range of middlemen and traders, so that the geographical origin of manuscripts is much more difficult to pin down than in the case of Wettstein or Schaeffer, who bought the vast majority of their manuscripts in Damascus. One of the important persons in this story and in Chester Beatty's network for buying manuscripts was Abraham Yehuda, a Jewish Orientalist from an Arabic-speaking family raised in Palestine, disenchanted by Zionism, subsequently living in Germany, in Spain, UK, US. He was a very active collector of manuscripts and a very active trader of manuscripts who also sold manuscripts to Chester Beatty. Yehuda might be a key person because Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts also appear in other modern collections which go back to him or which were constituted via him. So Chester Beatty bought quite a number of manuscripts from Yehuda. Another case in point is the collection in Jerusalem in the National Library, where his personal collection went after a very prolonged court battle in the US. Many of his family members did not want to go to Israel, but in the end they went to Israel, and which again include Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, or a very large corpus of manuscripts which were sold in 1942 to Robert Garrett on behalf of Princeton University. So all these collections, Chester Beatty, Jerusalem National Library, Princeton, have Abraham Yehuda as the common link. They all include Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscript, such as here we have one of the Princeton examples, which is the fragment of a title page of a geographical dictionary, which again is an autograph by Ibn Abdul Hadi, and which for a change has not just a summary ijaza for his children, but in more detail he says that some American mutafarika, men whom in lafti by my reading, waladi bulbul. So a slave who had fathered him a child is mentioned as one of those who attended. Then his son Badr ad-Din Hassan, the sister of Hassan Fatima, and Fatima's mother Jauhara. And Jauhara again obviously is a name which is typically given for slaves. And that's another feature of Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, that he loved to sit down with his family and had these reading sessions, including all members of his family. And the women, the mother of his children, were almost always present. Now, how and why Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts were available to European buyers in the late 19th and early 20th century is a story that still needs to be told. It is certainly closely interlinked with the trade in material artifacts, i.e. the art market, which came during the same period up and in the course of which many material artifacts moved into European and US American collections. And any attempt to understand the manuscript market cannot be separated from understanding the art market, because it's clear that similar key people were involved in this trade. However, what is evident is that the move in the late 19th century did not necessarily mobilize manuscripts which had rested for centuries in madrasas. We had already seen in the case of the Berlin manuscript this Ibn al-Munayr, who had owned this manuscript in the early 19th century. And this Princeton catalog again indicates that fascinating stories need to be told about book trade prior to the 19th century. Here we see a certain Ibrahim ibn Suleiman ibn Muhammad ibn Abdulaziz al-Hanafi, who 250 years before the manuscript were sold to Yehuda, had it already in private possession. So again, this manuscript had left the endowment long before it came into the European circuits of book markets. Now, as I mentioned, the inner Middle Eastern movement, it is once again important to underline that the late 19th century moment of manuscripts toward Europe is easy to identify. It's quite easy to find, relatively easy to identify these manuscripts. But it is certainly not the only time and direction of how manuscripts moved. And we see quite a lot of inner Middle Eastern movement. We had already seen the manuscript traveling to Morocco, today in Escorial. And many more manuscripts are today held in Istanbul in the Süleymaniye Library, and especially numerous in Cairo in the Dar al-Kutub, where we find, again, many of these manuscripts, same feature. You can see it as an autograph. And then we have, again, as Sama, where, again, the family members are mentioned who participated in this session. If we take a step back, it is evident that the late 19th century was a period of particularly intensive movement of manuscripts, and that the 20th century was a period where we had a relatively stable situation with many manuscripts remaining in the same library for almost a century, be it in Istanbul, in the Süleymaniye, be it in Damascus, be it in Cairo, but also in Escorial or other collection. So the danger of focusing of the late 19th century is obviously that we underestimate previous moments of manuscript movements in the early modern period, but we will only be able to really research these early modern movements if we have the large-scale databases of manuscript notes, because only then will we be able to identify the buyers, the users, the sellers, the middlemen, etc. There's no point in identifying Ibn al-Munayyar, who pops up 10 times in Berlin. We also have to identify what's going on in Princeton, in Chester Beatty, in Süleymaniye, in Dar al-Kutub, etc. And then we will really get a feeling of who were actually those people driving the trade in these cities. Okay, now in order to reconstitute the Ibn Abdul Hadi collection, it is evidently not only necessary to look to modern-day libraries in other cities, but a vast number of his manuscripts remained in Damascus, where they are currently held in the Syrian National Library, or Assad Library, as it is currently called. And as we have seen, the Fihris itself is currently held in Damascus, in this library. One of the problems when working on the historical trajectory of manuscripts today held in the Damascus Library is that the history has been obliterated in the way they were classified. Okay, now it's become slightly technical, but it's quite straightforward. The Syrian National Library started to be founded in 1879 when the manuscripts, it was evidently not founded as the Syrian National Library, but it was founded as the Ottoman Public Library. And it was founded as part of the Ottoman drive to create centralized libraries in many cities of the empire. It became slowly something like the National Central Library until it houses 16,000 manuscripts, which are today housed in this not too splendid building. When developing the classmax system for these manuscripts, the librarians took a very pragmatic decision, namely to just number all manuscripts consecutively from 1 to wherever the number stands, from 1 to 16,000. Which is wonderful from a librarian's perspective, probably, but a very unfortunate decision, which, for example, the Süleymaniye Library did not take. The Süleymaniye is basically the exact pendant to the Syrian National Library, i.e. a library which slowly has become the national, it's never called the national, but kind of the national depository for manuscripts. The librarians of the Süleymaniye took the decision to retain in their class mark system the name of the madrasa or mosque from where they got the manuscripts. So that for any Süleymaniye library, if you walk into the Süleymaniye, you open manuscripts, you're in the 19th century. in terms of library history. You immediately know where it came from Hagia Sophia, from Fatih, or from one of the other libraries. But for the Syrian National Library, we have a much longer way to make before we even arrive at this point, before we even understand what's going on in this ClassMag system. And obviously, we find the same problems in European libraries, for example, Chester Beatty, which is ruthlessly just 1 to 2,600, end of story. But at least for Damascus, we have an accession catalogue, which was written in 1882, when this Ottoman new public library was founded. It's not a big catalogue. It only contains 15% of all manuscripts which are in Damascus. But at least it's a beginning, and fortunately so, they mention from which library they sourced the manuscripts. So this is really gold for the historian of libraries, that at least for these manuscripts, we have very clear information. And this accession catalog thus allows tracking down a large number of relevant Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, such as this example, where we find again his very distinctive handwriting here in two different notes. And where we again find the endowment note for a Dhi'iyya manuscript. I had again been endowed in the Dhi'iyya previously. And sadly, we also find the late 19th century Ottoman, that's the Ottoman stamp, that's the Syrian post-independence stamp. And both periods had a love to put their stamps on parts which are quite interesting for us as readers today, with little regard of what we are interested in. When looking at Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts that made the way into the Zahiriya Library, which became the Syrian National Library, which became the Assad Library, another feature is evident when it comes to identifying historical collections. I said the modern ClassMag seem to be a rather meaningless series of random numbers, just 1 to 16,000. However, it is evident that these ClassMags have inscribed in them considerable historical information once you start to dig deeper into them. Because we see that certain clusters of Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts, for example, appear. Namely, between the ClassMag 3700 and 3900 in the current Assad Library, we find 180 Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts which had once been endowed to the Umariya. So even though these numbers just look like numbers, de facto we see that certain corpora have traveled together over 500 years and are still visible once we start to analyze the ClassMag systems. And there's another cluster around 4,500 of very small booklets, which again all had once belonged to the Ibn Abdul Hadi endowment. And the same goes for the Süleymaniye Library, where within the historical collection, for example, Fatih, which has 4,000 manuscripts roughly, it's just 1 to 4,000. But we again find clusters of historical collections. And the most interesting bit is that I found a cluster of Ashrafiya manuscripts, i.e. this library from the 13th century, is basically reflected in early 20th century ClassMag system. So over 700 years, these manuscripts have traveled together and have sat in different libraries on shelves next to each other, so that until today in the Süleymaniye, they still sit next to each other, which is kind of a consolation if you think about all these movements of these poor manuscripts. So when we combine the evidence we have from manuscript notes with the profile of modern-day libraries, this allows us to reconstitute the trajectory of manuscripts. But much more importantly, for my purposes, it allows the holdings that were on the shelves of the multitude of libraries in a city such as Damascus during the medieval period to be historicized once again. So what I've shown here today is basically the first step to bridge the gap between medieval library and modern-day libraries. But it is evident that in between these two points, there are fascinating stories to be told on manuscript movements and the history of libraries in the Ottoman or early modern period. And to conclude, one example. Many of the Ibn Abdul Hadi manuscripts contain one very striking feature, and that is that they contain legal documents which were cut into pieces and reused in order to produce manuscripts. So this is a contract of land, which was sold during the Ayyubid period in Damascus, Seemingly the owner had no use of it anymore and was cut into pieces and reused as a wrapping for a hadith manuscript. These documents were normally on parchment, so quite sturdy and quite good to be reused for these purposes. We don't have time to discuss this practice in more detail. It's just important to mention that this reuse material does not only include Arabic material, but also, for example, this extract from the Bible, which is in Georgian script, or quite often we find Latin material in these manuscripts. In this case, a Latin text, namely the Decretals by Burkhard of Worms, i.e. a work of canon law, that must have circulated in the Frankish Middle East, in the crusading Middle East, Frankish Middle East. And as you can see, there's an Arabic title written on top of it, which is Asabir al-Ishrun Bad al-Mir. So it's the 127th part, Fidam Vi al-Wajhain. So it's in condemnation of the hypocrite. Quite a known work on hadith by the scholar Ibn Asakir. This fragment is today in a private collection, Skuyen collection in Oslo. And the interesting bit is that this title page, together with a number of other title pages which carry the same class mark in the Skuyen collection, 1776, were removed from Arabic manuscripts and started to be traded individually. When they were offered for sale by Sotheby's in 1993, they were given a slightly fanciful history. They represent an astonishing single clutch of fragments of 12th century manuscripts, which they believed to have survived in Damascus. That's right. They were already demonstrably in the Middle East by the late 12th or 13th century. They were used as flyleaves or wrappers in a series of fascicules of the tales of Arabian Nights. Obviously, you have to bring in the 1001 Nights if you want to sell manuscripts. There's nothing, nothing whatsoever. It's all hadith. But 1001 Nights. And some Arabic unvocalized, that's all fine. And the end is, it can suggest only one source. These are relics from the manuscripts carried off by the Saracens, and we're back in the 19th century, when the Latin kingdom of Jerusalem fell to Saladin in October 1187, and the sacristy of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre was looted and destroyed. There's no evidence whatsoever that this happened. It's just a good story to tell, and Jerusalem has to come up. If you want to sell something Middle Eastern, obviously 1001 Nights, Jerusalem is a great combination. But I'm rather distrustful of this story, as the Skuyen 1776 fragments are part of a very widespread reuse of written material circulating in Damascus. As I said, Georgian, Armenian, Arabic, Greek, Hebrew, you name it. And the main point is that this manuscript, which is today in the National Library in Damascus, which is Al-Majlis al-Sabir wal-Ishrun Bad al-Mir Fi Dam Dhi al-Wajhain by Ibn Asakir, is the place where this title page, which is in Skuyen collection today, originally belongs. This is basically the manuscript from where this title page has been removed, and for virtually all of the Skuyen 1776 fragments, it's possible to identify the Damascene origin of these fragments. When exactly it was removed is entirely unclear, and we also do not know evidently how it surfaced on the markets in the 1919, and that's certainly a different story which needs to be told. However, what this shows is that reconstituting medieval libraries does not only provide decisive insights into the history of Damascene society at that period itself, and this is obviously my main interest, which is not necessarily shared by anybody, but it also allows reconstituting such libraries and recontextualizing manuscripts and fragments that would otherwise continue to be seen as decontextualized textual witnesses of a rather poorly defined Islamic Middle East devoid of a specific regional, chronological, or social context. And because if they remain decontextualized, they also remain without a chance to pin down who owned them, who were the producers, who were the sellers, the buyers, the readers, the traders of these items. Reconstituting medieval libraries is not primarily concerned with deciding legal questions of rightful ownership, but it does allow developing methodologies to give back a history to otherwise orphaned manuscripts and orphaned fragments, which are currently housed in Oslo, Dublin, Escorial, Berlin, Princeton, Paris, Cairo, Istanbul, or Damascus. Thank you very much.
If there are any questions, if you could kindly state your name before asking the question.
Thank you very much. It's Kazvan Butrus from University of Kent. Very fascinating, and thank you very much. And it is actually a core of my interest in the movement of the books, actually. Okay. But what I want to ask you is, and I know you haven't alluded to it, but you probably have a lot of knowledge. What is the book trade looks like inside Damascus over the last three centuries, where these Abdul Hadi's books has been moving around? What kind of book is the trade are there? I mean, the antiquarian bookshops and things like that.
I mean, it's certainly not one of the fields where we have a lot of research. So there's not a dedicated monograph or even a dedicated research article on that. So what we have are colleagues who have touched upon it here and there. So it's a very fragmented picture. The best picture which we get is a book which came out last year, by Boris Liebrenz on the Rifa'iya Library, which was moved from Damascus to Leipzig in the 1860s, roughly. And this gives us some insight into what was going on in Damascus. And what is evident is that we have a high number of specialized middlemen who had a very clear understanding of what external buyers wanted and who were able to bring together collections for them, which they would then ship off to Europe. So there was a highly professionalized market. And if we then look further back, it's clear that this is not something which was triggered by European demand, but that we have these booksellers, these book traders, for a long period, he only changed basically their profile once the European sellers come in. And as far as we know, this is basically an area to the north of the Umayyad mosque and to the east of the Umayyad mosque, where we have areas of paper selling, and where we also have kind of the waste paper industry, so to say, i.e. this reuse practices which I showed. And they were also all situated in this northeast of the Umayyad mosque. So there was a market area where you basically could buy it. Just one point, I don't know whether that is also what you were aiming at. There was no problem whatsoever to sell manuscripts which had been endowed previously. Because quite interestingly, these waqf notes are not removed. You know what I mean? That's what you would expect. I mean, if I kind of buy a book which, you know, has an origin which is not that great, and I stole it from Soas Library, first of all, I cut out the stamp to make sure that it becomes neutral. But they never removed the waqf stamp. So this trade, with this constant move between endowed property and private property, was not at all illegitimate. And this has certainly fed the market to a very large extent. I mean, the assumption had at least my assumption was always, that waqf is relatively stable and, you know, you would not really trade in them. But because this was not seen as something to be avoided, the Damascene book traders did not necessarily rely so much on the production of new books, but had a constant, or were able to source constantly historical books from collections.
Yes, my name is Ali Al-Mihdhar. I'm a lawyer in London and in Saudi Arabia. I had a question which you've just, Professor, just partially answered already, but it's about the distinction between a waqf as a permanent institution and it being transferable. It's easy to understand the transfer of books and the migration of books once they're stolen. But the original owners or the original people who were guardians of those waqfs shouldn't have meddled with them. Otherwise, it will not be a waqf, it will be something else. Yeah. So there is that basic conflict, I think, in the in the notion of the waqf and the transmigration of books from one location to another.
The most probably what happened especially from the 15th century onward, is istibdal, i.e. that you have the possibility to exchange an endowed property for another property, and that you exchange an endowed book for something else. The problem is we don't have a single trace of istibdal with regard to books. Obviously, if it comes to property, you know, that's, I mean, no problem. I mean, on the waqfiyats, you quite often have these istibdal notes. But for the books, I've not yet seen a single book where somebody said, okay, it was waqf of the ayah, but, you know, because of a istibdal, this is no legitimate sale. However, what we do see quite often is when there is a waqf statement that we have the following note of possession is not possession note with malaka or tamalaka, but it's sale note with ba'a. And there it's always underlined that it's ba'i shari, so in conformity to the sharia. And this is something which we do not find very often in non-waqf books. So I guess the fact that they stress this is a sharia-conform transaction, which is here noted on the manuscripts, does indicate that it was validated by a judge, though we don't have signatures for this, but it must have been validated by a judge, and that most likely it worked via istibdal, i.e. that Abdel Hadi was able to get it out by exchanging it for something different, whatever that might have been.
Yes, thank you very much. My name is Ahmed Al-Dubayan. I'm the Director General of the Islamic Cultural Center in London. I have a question about this, again, the movement, of course, of the books. We know from history that is in 19th century, there were really a lot of activities from France, from Britain, from Germany also, in opening what we call them consulate offices in Aleppo, Damascus, Jerusalem, in many cities in Syria, or in Sham, in the original meaning of Sham. And don't you think these consulate sections actually, or offices, were open? They were really maybe active in collecting these things, and that could give us some light about how come then all these books move in that time, many of them in the 19th century, to the Western countries.
I mean, you're entirely right. I mean, basically all the booksellers, big names.
Yeah, especially also there was economic activities there, because also the consulate section themselves, they were actually requested to the Ottoman Empire in Istanbul. In that time, the excuse, or the reason actually, not excuse, the reason was really to their citizens who really very actively working in the commerce there, in the trading in Syria. And that's why actually that was requested to allow these offices to be open, and they opened them. They were many, especially after the problems between the Christians and the Muslims in Syria in the 19th century. You know, yes, to give some protection. And I think that can maybe cast some light. How come these manuscripts, all of them, really collected maybe through middlemen, as you said, to sell them? Yeah.
I mean, that's.
Thank you.
First of all, I mean, as a general framework, there's obviously no question that the late 19th century movement is expression of a certain balance or imbalance of power between two world regions, and that obviously these were sales, legal sales, so to say, but obviously there's a political larger context to this. And all of the booksellers, Charles Schaeffer, Wettstein, and also the others, they were at the same time Orientalists, so they could read the languages. They were diplomats. So Wettstein was the Prussian consul in Damascus for an extended period. Schaeffer was the French consul in Damascus for an extended period. They were also all businessmen. So they all had their own business on the side. So for them, this manuscript collection was quite often something which was not too difficult to other business enterprises that they ran. And Wettstein, obviously, he sold all his manuscripts. It's not that he endowed them afterwards to Berlin Library or gave them as a gift, but he sold them, and he sold them to quite a good price, and he made a hefty sum of money out of these manuscripts. I mean, I've very much spoken about this whole movement in very neutral terms, because obviously there are many different contexts why manuscripts move, but there's no question that there's a clear political context to what happens in the late 19th century and why so many manuscripts move over. It's only basically the only one who's not a diplomat, and when things change, is Abraham Yehuda. He's basically the one big figure in late 19th, early 20th century manuscript trade who is not a diplomat.
From Damascus? Or?
No, from Palestine, from Jerusalem. He was raised in Jerusalem, but it's quite a multi-ethnic family. So it's to label him as Palestinian, I guess, would not do justice to this very checkered background of his family.
Thank you. Well, Simon Marnie from UCL. Thank you for a fantastic, very, very interesting lecture. The movement of objects, yeah, very, very tricky. an earlier point you made, a point at the very beginning, was the impossibility of separating the movement of books from art objects as well. So thinking about the 19th century and thinking about many, many examples that we have in the UK, in private house collections, indeed the British Museum has many, objects that have been collected by tourists on their grand tour. Right? Mm. In the 19th century, you'd have the English gentlemen will round off their education by a tour of Europe. They go to Italy and Greece and places like this. And then they bring home art objects with them. Right? And of course, not knowing and not being experts in the art objects, there was a huge industry in reworking sort of later marble works in a classical style and then selling them to, in effect, what were the non-specialist tourists that would bring them home. And to quote even the Roman Cicero, when instructing his agent to purchase art objects, just used to say to his friends, well, tell them it's by Praxiteles because nobody will know the difference. So there's a burgeoning trade, I guess, in the 19th century of reworking artworks in the classical style and selling them off to the British tourists, and I'm sure for the rest of the Europeans as well. So what I wanted to ask you is, do you find the similar thing with manuscripts and books as well? Was there a market for reworking more recent manuscripts and books into an older style and then selling them spuriously to non-expert buyers?
Mm. What certainly happens is once you have non-expert entering the market, then you have this phenomenon. For example, in the early 19th century, the ducal household of Gotha in Middle Germany sponsored an astronomical scientific expedition to the Middle East. And the guy who was running it had no Arabic, but he was also instructed to buy manuscripts. And so he bought manuscripts in Istanbul, then he went to Aleppo, and then he finally started to learn Arabic, but was not that strong, bought manuscripts in Damascus, traveled to Jerusalem. Then in Cairo, he finally really got around Arabic and was able to read it. And you see a clear shift in quality in the manuscripts which were shipped back to Gotha, and that the earlier they date, the less valuable they are. And most probably he was quite often tricked on the market by middlemen who told him that this was this amazing historical collection and he just lacked the expertise. But guys like Schaeffer, Wettstein, etc., they were real experts. And so it would have been rather difficult to trick them. And they were aware, for example, when the Prussians, Wettstein, arrived on the market, the British and French had already been there and had bought quite a number of manuscripts. So the manuscript market had become less attractive. The big old stuff had gone. So what he bought was a lot of Ottoman period popular tales, Sirat Beybars, for example, which, you know, at that point everybody thought, you know, kind of popular trash. What, nobody bought it, but he bought it, and I mean, thanks to him, Berlin has the most amazing collection of the Ottoman period Sira works. And he really had a feeling for manuscripts and for what is important, and to trick him would have been quite difficult. Just the last example, this Boris, Libre, no, gosh, no, I forgot his name, Boris, the name of Boris, who worked on the Refa'ir library. Librens, sorry, who worked on the Refa'ir library, 19th century, shipped from Damascus to Leipzig as one whole. They had experts sent over, specimens sent to Leipzig, expertise written, etc. So they were very careful of what they were buying. So for sure it happened, but not with these guys, not with the big names.
I have other two last questions.
Thank you, Darius Abu Seif Soas. Did you come across the Vatican Library and their purchase? I think they have been quite early involved in acquiring Middle Eastern books, and they were helped by Maronite middlesmen. Is the collection of any relevance to your study and to the work you've been showing today and to Ayyubid and Mamluk manuscripts, for example?
To be quite honest, I've never worked on the Vatican library, but I guess I've also never worked on it because nothing has come up so far, you know, which is in the Vatican library, so there's certainly a certain logic to that. And it's true that the Vatican library obviously started by much earlier than Paris, and especially like Berlin or Leipzig or any of those places. So, but if you look at the early modern period, and there is an article which came out last year and past and present on early modern book trade in the Middle East and European buyers going to the Middle East, and basically how that's 16th, early 17th century, and how they were able to buy books. And what is striking is the high number of Christians who were basically the middlemen, the first contacts, etc., and who directed them to, and who directed them to the sources. And it seems that if we look at the earliest manuscripts which move over, that we have a relatively large percentage from Christian collection, Christian owners, because they were the ones who were basically the first contacts and where they were in the networks and where they were able to buy it. Wettstein, etc., this does not seem to be the case. Schaefer, they bring over 95% Muslim manuscripts, and their contacts, middlemen, seem to have been very well connected within Muslim institution, Muslim book trading networks.
Thank you very much. My name is Marcel Abbas. I used to work in manuscripts. First of all, I would like to point out that the late Mahmoud Shakir, in his book Al-Mutanabbi, the prologue, is an excellent introduction to how actually manuscripts were taken out of Egypt.
Late 19th century.
That's right, yes. In fact, he was talking from the Napoleon times up to the late 1900.
European buyers basically
coming in. Yes. With regard to actually libraries made available to the public, there is someone in Basra called Al-Aswari, Abu Ali Al-Aswari. He actually had two public libraries. One of them was in Basra and the other one was in Askar Makram, in southern parts of Iran.
That's what period?
I'm talking about the 4th century.
Ah, okay.
Actually, they were libraries. They are meant for the public. One good reference would be Al-Nadim, Kitab al-Fihrist. With regard to trying and to trace the owners of manuscripts, I tried very hard when Al-Furqan was launching the survey with Al-Naqshbandi with regard to the Iraqi manuscripts which were held by Dar Saddam al-Makhtutat. I wrote to him asking him to try and actually give the origin of each manuscript that was actually taken to Saddam's to Dar Saddam al-Makhtutat, because he has collected probably the best manuscripts available in Iraq. Okay.
I would like to thank you again, Professor Konrad, for this great lecture, and thank you all for being here, and hopefully we'll see you all here again for our next event, in particular the launch of the book about the history of Aleppo in October. Thank you so much.